Good morning. This is my review of the second part of Unit 5, Torque and Rotational Dynamics for AP Physics 1. This video covers torque, rotational inertia, rotational equilibrium, and the rotational forms of Newton's first and second laws.
Flippin' physics!
This video is a free portion of my AP Physics 1 Ultimate Review Packet. If you are enrolled in AP Physics 1 this year, I definitely recommend you get my full AP Physics 1 Ultimate Review Packet. Link is in the video description. Billy, what is torque?
Torque, for which the symbol is lowercase tau, is the ability of a force to cause an angular acceleration of an object.
Thank you, Billy. Bobby, what is the equation for torque?
The equation for torque is torque equals R, the distance from the axis of rotation to the location where the force acts on the object, times F, the force causing the torque, times the sine of theta, where theta is the angle between the directions of R and F in the torque equation.
Thank you, Bobby. Now, let's say we have a door, and we are looking at the door from above. The hinge of that door is on the left side of the door, which means that is where the axis of rotation of this door is. If we push on the door, causing a force applied, and torque as shown in the illustration, Bo, where should we draw R in this illustration?
R is the distance from the axis of rotation to the location where the force acts on the object. So R should start at the axis of rotation and go all the way over to where the force is applied to the door.
That means theta, the angle between the direction of R, which is to the right, and the direction of the force applied, which is up and to the right, is between the force applied and a line drawn horizontally, which extends the line for R to the right. Right, Mr. P?
That is correct, Billy. Now, we can add a dotted line which is parallel to the direction of the force applied and goes down and to the left. This is called the line of action of the force. And we can add another line which goes from the axis of rotation to the line of action of the force and is perpendicular to the line of action of the force. Can one of you tell me what this line is called?
That looks familiar.
Yeah.
It is called the lever arm, and the symbol for the lever arm is R with a subscript of perpendicular. The lever arm is the perpendicular distance from the axis of rotation to the line of action of the force. The equation for the lever arm is that R perpendicular equals R times sine theta.
Yeah. Another equation for torque is that torque equals the lever arm times the force.
Yep.
Correct, Billy. The units for torque are newtons times meters, which is the same as the units for work and energy. However, we use the term joules for the units for work and energy to distinguish between the two.
What?
A joule is a newton meter.
But we use newton meters as the units for torque and joules as the units for work and energy to identify them as different.
Okay, sure.
Right. Also, work and energy are scalars. However, torque is a vector. Therefore, torque has both magnitude and direction. Right. And in AP Physics 1, we use clockwise and counterclockwise to indicate the direction of torque. When working with torque, we draw force diagrams of all the forces acting on an object. The objects are no longer point particles, they are rigid objects with shape. This means we need to indicate in our force diagrams where the forces act on the object. Just to be clear, Bobby, how are force diagrams different than free body diagrams?
In a free body diagram, all force vectors start at the center of mass of the object. In a force diagram, all force vector arrows start at the locations where the forces act on the object. This is because for torque, the objects are no longer point particles and it matters where the forces act on the object, because the same force acting at a different location on the same object can cause a different torque.
Exactly right, Bobby. Thanks. Billy, tell me everything you know about rotational inertia.
Absolutely. Rotational inertia, for which the symbol is uppercase I, is a measure of how much a point particle, rigid object, or rigid system resists angular acceleration. The rotational inertia of the point particle around an axis of rotation equals mr squared, where m is the mass of the point particle and r is the distance between the axis of rotation and the location of the point particle. I do not have to say the location of the center of mass of the point particle because point particles have no shape or size. The base SI units for rotational inertia are kilograms times meters squared. For a system of particles, the equation for rotational inertia is the rotational inertia of a system of particles equals the sum of the rotational inertias of the system, or sigma capital I with a subscript of lowercase I, where lowercase I stands for integer. And that integer is the total number of particles in the system. So that equals the sum of the m with a subscript of lowercase I times the square of r with a subscript of lowercase I. And just to be clear about what that equation means, if there are two particles in a system, the equation for the rotational inertia of the system about an axis of rotation is that it equals the mass of the first particle times the square of the distance the first particle is from the axis of rotation, plus the mass of the second particle times the square of the distance the second particle is from the axis of rotation. And I do not know what you want me to say about the rotational inertias of rigid objects with shape.
Well done, Billy. I'll talk about that. If there is ever an instance where you need an equation for the rotational inertia of a rigid object with shape on the AP Physics 1 exam, that equation will be provided for you. For example, the rotational inertia of a uniform solid sphere about an axis through its center of mass is 2/5 m times r squared, where m is the mass of the solid sphere and r is the radius of the solid sphere. And realize the term uniform in uniform solid sphere means the sphere has a uniform density. The sphere has the same density throughout its entire shape. And the rotational inertia of a thin hollow sphere about an axis through its center of mass is 2/3 mass times radius squared. Now, on the AP exam, you may be asked to compare the rotational inertias of two different objects about their axes of rotation without knowing the equations for their rotational inertias. In order to do that, realize that the larger the percentage of mass an object has farther away from its axis of rotation, the larger its rotational inertia will be. This is because r, the distance the mass is from the axis of rotation, is squared in the rotational inertia equation. For example, you should be able to tell, without knowing their equations for rotational inertia about an axis through their centers of mass, that, assuming they have the same mass and same radius, the rotational inertia of a uniform solid sphere about an axis through its center of mass is less than the rotational inertia of a thin hollow sphere about an axis through its center of mass. This is because, on average, the mass of a uniform solid sphere is closer to its center of mass than the mass of a thin hollow sphere is to its center of mass. A uniform solid sphere simply has more mass near an axis through its center of mass than a thin hollow sphere does. Okay, class. In order to determine the rotational inertia of anything, a particle, a system of particles, a rigid object with shape, in order to determine rotational inertia, you need to first identify what?
The axis of rotation.
Exactly. Please be careful of that. Without defining an axis of rotation of a system, you cannot determine a system's rotational inertia. Next, Bo. Tell me everything you remember about the parallel axis theorem.
Sure. This is the thing where you can find the rotational inertia of an object about a different axis if you have its rotational inertia about its center of mass, right?
Yes, Bo, that is the one.
Okay. If you have the equation for the rotational of inertia of a uniform rigid object with shape about its center of mass, you can determine the rotational inertia of that object about another axis by using the parallel axis theorem. That equation is capital I, the rotational inertia about the new axis, equals capital I with a subscript of Cm for the rotational inertia of the uniform rigid object with shape about its center of mass, plus capital M, the mass of the object, times the square of capital D, the distance from the center of mass of the uniform rigid object with shape to the new axis of rotation.
Oh, that equation shows us that the smallest value for rotational inertia of a uniform rigid object with shape will have is when the axis of rotation passes through its center of mass.
How?
The smallest value for the rotational inertia of the object will be when D equals zero.
And when D equals zero, the axis of rotation passes through the center of mass of the uniform rigid object with shape.
Sure.
Well done, everybody. Next up, we have rotational equilibrium and Newton's first law in rotational form. But first, let's review translational equilibrium. Class, when a system is in translational equilibrium, the net force in the system equals zero, so the acceleration of the system is zero, so the linear velocity of the system is what?
Constant.
Right, constant.
Yeah.
Bobby, Tell me all of that only for rotational equilibrium instead.
When a system is in rotational equilibrium, the net torque on the system equals zero, so the angular acceleration of the system is zero, so the angular velocity of the system is constant.
Thank you, Bobby. Billy, please tell me the linear form of Newton's first law.
Newton's first law, the linear form, states that an object at rest remains at rest, and an object in motion maintains a constant velocity unless acted upon by a net external force.
And Billy, how about you give us the rotational form as well?
Certainly. The rotational form of Newton's second law states that an object at rest remains at rest, and a rotating object maintains a constant angular velocity unless acted upon by a net external torque. Is there more?
There's more.
There is another way, other than a net external torque, that can cause a system to change its angular velocity.
Yep.
Oh, something could change the shape of the object, and therefore change the rotational inertia of the object, and therefore, because the angular momentum remains the same, change the angular velocity of the object, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
Yes.
And
let's add or distribution of the mass of the object changes to the end of the rotational form of Newton's first law. And now let's talk about Newton's second law in rotational form. A linear form of Newton's second law is net force equals mass times acceleration. The rotational equivalent of this is that net torque equals rotational inertia times angular acceleration. From this, we can see that the rotational equivalent of force is torque. The rotational equivalent of mass is rotational inertia, and the rotational equivalent of linear acceleration is angular acceleration. Remember, when summing the torques about an object, you must first identify the objects you are summing the torques on, the axis of rotation, and the positive angular direction. Then draw a force diagram. And lastly, an object which is at rest and is not rotating is in both translational and rotational equilibrium, and is in what we call static equilibrium. And the net torque about any axis of rotation is equal to zero. That is right. When an object is in static equilibrium, the net torque about any axis of rotation is zero. So, typically, we pick an axis of rotation which makes the problem mathematically easier to solve. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoy learning with you.